Welcome. This from 770 Eastern Parkway, the Rebbe's headquarters. My name is Elkanah Shmutkin. This coming Shabbos, we'll be celebrating 143 years from the birth of Rebbe Tzinchana, the Rebbe's mother. And tonight we're going to be having a special opportunity to look at actual artifacts here in the Rebbe's library, four of them to be precise, by and about Rebbe Tzinchana. First, let's share a brief few points about her life, and then we'll go upstairs and we will see the actual documents about her. She was born in 1880 on the 28th of Tevis to Rabbi Meir Shlema and Rabbitzin Rachel Yanovsky. Rabbi Meir Shlema was the chief rabbi of the city of Nikolaev, and before him, his father-in-law, Rabbitzin Chana's grandfather, Rabbi Avram David Lavut, was the rabbi before him. She had three siblings, two younger sisters, and a younger brother, Yisrael Leib, who passed away in his youth. The environment when she grew up was very much in a rabbinic family. Reb Meir Shlema, her father, was a yeshiv, a close chassid, a devoted chassid of the Rebbe Marash. And the Rebbe says about Rebbe Tzinchana that as a girl, she would write over chassidus of the Rebbe Rashab at the time, which is both, she would write, in those days there were no printing presses, so she would actually write over the Ma'amarim, whether they were the original manuscripts that would come from the Rebbe or from a chaser, from those who would write down the Rebbe Rashab's talks after Shabbos or after his talk. So, and the Rebbe actually notes that she used to write very quickly and very accurately. Rebbe Tzinchana had a beautiful voice and she loved singing Hasidic melodies, Hasidic Nigunim. In general, Nikolaev is known for its Nigunim, the beautiful Chabad Nigunim of Nikolaev, and Rebbe Tzinchana loved those Nigunim and sang them. Her shidduch with the Rebbe's father, Rabbi Levi Yitzchak, was actually suggested by the Rebbe Rashab himself, and he was, the Rebbe says about his father, that the Rebbe Levi Yitzchak was an extremely devoted chassid of the Rebbe Rashab. And during their engagement, Rebbe Tzinchana got sick, and Rebbe Meir Shlema wanted to postpone the chasana, but postpone the wedding. But the Rebbe Rashab said no, they need to keep the wedding at the time that they had allotted, and she was better by the time the wedding came. And their wedding happened in Sivan, 1900. The chasana, the Rebbe's father was 22 years old, and Rebbe Tzinchana was 20 years old at the wedding. And 2 years after their marriage, they had their first child, our Rebbe, the Rebbe, followed 2 years later by the Rebbe's brother, Beryl, Leif Ber, followed 2 years later by Label. I'm sorry. Followed 2 years later by Yisrael Aryeh Label. Now, before we go into the library, I just want to show you, because sometimes it's hard to understand from inside where we are. We're actually going to be inside the top floor, the third floor of 770, those windows up there to the right. So once we go up through the library, we're going to be in that room over there, which is where we're going to be seeing the documents and manuscripts. From her marriage, she lived, Rebbe Tzinchana lived by her parents. Lived in the home, Rebbe Tzinchana of Levi Yitzchak lived in the home of Rebbe Meir Shlema and Rebbe Rachel for 7 years, where he studied and he wrote Torah and he served Hashem until it became time, as Rebbe Tzinchana writes, until it became time to go out and find his own parnasa, and at which point he became the rabbi. There was a search amongst a bunch of different cities, and he became the rabbi of Dnepropetrovsk, today called Dnipro. I actually want to just stop for a minute. Shabbos was the first time that the city of, today it's called Dnipro, was bombed very, very seriously. Scores of people were killed, scores of people were injured. Want to, together on this Fabregen, want to wish that all the Jewish community, the general population of the city should be safe and should be well in the schus of hosting the Rebbe and the Rebbe's family for many years. I think it was 17 years that the Rebbe lived there. I mean, it being the city of the Rebbe's childhood, let's give them a bracha that that should be peaceful, and in general, there should be peace throughout. For more on Rebbe Tzvichana's life, so listen, we're not going to try and do an entire biography standing outside and walking up the stairs of the Rebbe's library. There's going to be links posted below of a film that we did on Rebbe Tzvichana. There's both the introduction piece that we did on YouTube, and then we have a full film that's on gem.tv. In addition, we're going to have links of many of the other things that many of the other things we're going to talk about tonight, Chabad.org, a short biography. This is the exhibition hall of the library. Before we go to the specific documents relating to Rebbe Tzvichana, I just want to tell you a little bit about the library. First of all, the Rebbe's library can accurately be called the crown jewel of the Lubavitch movement. It's documents that began from the Alter Rebbe all the way through to the Rebbe. And as we know, the Rebbe really loved this precious library and held it very preciously. The famed library trial was over the ownership of this library. And in this exhibition hall, there's always a beautiful exhibition put on by the librarians, led by Rabbi Levin, of artifacts and svarim, books and manuscripts of the Rabbein. Starting here, we have from the Alter Rebbe, the first generation of Chabad Chassidus. We have the Alter Rebbe's handwriting here. And there's one display case presently from each of the Rabbein. The Mittler Rebbe, the second generation, the Alter Rebbe's son. As you see, there's not only Svarim and artifacts, books and artifacts, but this is a Megillah written by the Rebbe Marash, the Alter Rebbe, the Mittler Rebbe. Here's the Tzemach Tzedek. This is the Rebbe Marash. Here we have items from the Rebbe Rashab. Here's his passport, handwriting, letters. And this is from the Friedeke Rebbe. And the Rebbe is over there. I strongly urge and invite everyone to visit the Rebbe's library. Come see this exhibition. There's absolutely wonderful artifacts, handwritten manuscripts, svarim, and you won't be disappointed. Also, before we start, I want to take a moment to thank the library staff, starting from Rabbi Beryl Levin, the chief librarian, Rabbi Yitzchak Wilhelm, and the entire staff. Their help to GEM in all of the videos that we produce, all of the books that we publish, is second to none on an ongoing basis. We would not be able to do what we do without their ongoing and tremendous assistance. And we really, really thank them for that, more than can be expressed here tonight. In addition, Rabbi Levin and the staff opened up here tonight and are allowing us this special opportunity to see some of these items up close. And for that, they get an additional thank you. So tonight, with regard to Rebbe Tzvichana, we're going to start with actually a document that is a copy, but I wanted to start with, in other words, the original is still in Russia, but I wanted to start with it because it is really testifies or speaks about Rebbe Tzvichana herself. Rebbe Baruch Schneier, the Rebbe's grandfather, had a unique relationship with the Rebbe Rashab. He was born in Lubavitch, and his father was the oldest grandson, his grandfather was the oldest son of the Tzemach Tzedek, Rebbe Baruch Sholem. And the Rebbe Marash said a special mimer for his first wedding, for his marriage to the Rebbe's grandmother. And for his second marriage, actually, the Rebbe Rashab himself escorted him to the chuppah. He was the unterfuhrer. So anyway, on Sunday, the 7th of Adar, 1915, this is a few days before the Rebbe, our Rebbe, put on tefillin for the first time, a month before his bar mitzvah. So he writes in his diary that Rebbe Rashab treated him with a tremendous amount of, accorded him a tremendous amount of respect. He told the Rebbe Rashab many things about the history of the sons of the Tzemach Tzedek and the earlier generations of Chabad. Very interesting relationship there. And when he would come to Lubavitch, he would dine, he would eat at the home of the Rebbe Rashab himself. So here he's telling the Rebbe Rashab about the fact that the Rebbe is going to be putting on tefillin for the first time in a few days, on the 11th of Adar. And he says that he asks for a bracha, that you know, through the putting on tefillin, his mind and his heart should be, there should be shibud amayach v'alev, they should be given over to Hashem, because that's what tefillin does. But then he speaks about Rebbe Tzinchana. He says, Gam kaloisa yichya, imahilchim b'faruch, my daughters-in-law go with a sheitel, umisnagim al derech ha-teirah v'amitzvahs, and they act in accordance with teirah mitzvahs. We're going to speak about her in a moment. My daughter-in-law, the wife of Shalom Shlomit, it was Yiras Hashem, Maskelis. She's God-fearing, etc. Acts according to Torah mitzvahs. But then he says about Rebbe Tzinchana that despite the fact that she is extremely well-read, Maskelis Me'oid, I believe he writes, Milumedis B'yoser, and Maskelis, nevertheless, she's very God-fearing. In those days, women were not scholars. And if someone was a scholar, even if it was in Torah knowledge, that could have often meant that there was something wrong with their status of their Jewish observance. Says that she acts according to Torah mitzvahs, and that's a description. And it happens to be the Friedrich Rebbe says in a sicha that Rebbe Baruch Schneer is extremely accurate with his writings. He was very careful. So it's just nice to get an account of the Rebbe's grandfather telling the Rebbe Rashab specifically about Rebbe Tzinchana. Okay, so that's the first thing. Now, in general, there's something that I personally find very interesting, and that is that Lubavitch history, the history of the Rebbeim, women play a very important role. In particular, I'm talking about two women. The Friedrich Rebbe, who's basically the chronicler of, you know, much of the history of the Rebbeim, of the Rebbes, much of what he learned was from his grandmother, Rebbetzin Rivka, the Rebbetzin of the Rebbe Marash. He used to go to her every day during his recess, and she would tell him the history of many, many interesting things from the history of the earlier generations of Chabad. And then, of course, our Rebbe, everything, much of what we know about the Rebbe's childhood comes from Rebbe Tzinchana. So it's fairly well known that over the last number of years, Rebbe Tzinchana's memoirs have been published. And there's much in them about the Rebbe's father's sufferings in exile and his torment by the Russian government, and also quite a bit about the Rebbe's childhood as well. He was arrested on the 9th of Nisan in 1939. And the Rebbe was already then in France, and shortly thereafter he went to the United States. These memoirs are available in English, in Hebrew, numerous other languages. You can get them on Chabad.org, and we're going to put a link to them down below. And I really invite everyone to read them. They are absolutely fascinating. They're heartbreaking. They're fascinating, but there's so much that can be learned from them. So we're just going to choose a few of them. But before we go to the memoirs themselves, I wanted to give some context as to what these memoirs are all about. Why did Rebbe Tzinchana write them? This here is a letter from Rebbe Tzinchana to her sister-in-law, Rebbe Tzin Rachel Schneerson, who lived in Yerushalayim. She was the wife of Reb Shalom Shloima, who Reb Shalom Shloima was Reb Levi Yitzchak's brother. And Rebbe Tzinchana writes to her about these memoirs and why she wrote them. And she writes as follows. Bitcha, your daughter, Zelda, this is the mother of the famed poet Zelda Mashkovsky Schneerson. Your daughter, Zelda, biksha etzli, lifnezman, lezikarin midoy de baili zal tmuna oyeze davar ledoima, achgam etzli ein. Your daughter asked me for a photo of my husband, but I don't have. However, when I arrived here 6 years ago, I marked down whatever remained in my memory of his exile and his last years when we were back in our city, because I wanted my son's shlita, may they be well, to know about them, because they were not with him. And I will send you a copy of them. And this is what Rebbe Tzimchana writes to her sister-in-law, why she wrote these memoirs. And the memoirs, as I mentioned, are fascinating. I'm not going to try and cover them all, but I really do urge you to read them. But three maybe somewhat random selections from them we'll choose. And again, I want to thank the Rebbe's library for allowing us this special access. The Rebbe Tzimchana's memoirs were written in two notebooks. The first one was the memoirs and the memories of Reb Levi Yitzchok in Golos, and Rebbe Tzimchana's assistance to him is obviously throughout it. And the second one has a little bit more about the Rebbe himself, and a little bit more about their time there together. So this one is from the 11th of Shvat, Yudal of Shvat, Tavshin Ches. And I'm going to jump ahead a little bit. She's talking about when it was 5 months after her husband had been arrested, and Rebbe Tzimchana writes already earlier how she had attempted to find where he is, and she traveled to Kiev and to numerous cities, and she was given the runaround, and she left food for him, and it never made it to him. And then she says as follows, while I was seeking solutions, no one would advise me, because everyone was afraid to get involved. I suddenly received a notice from the Yekaterinoslav prison, because he had been in Kiev, but then they brought him back to Yekaterinoslav, informing me that Levik Zalmanovich Schneerson, you see, Lamed Zayin Shin Samach, Levik Zalmanovich, Gefinzich can be found in the following room in this prison. And you can send them food or money. Supply him with food or money. So this is the first news, the first clear indication she had that he was even alive. So first of all, she says, I was overjoyed to know that he was alive. And then she says that the days when the prisoners' families could bring them food or whatever it is were determined by the alphabet. And of course, his turn fell out on Shabbos. She said that she knew that it was absolute sakanas nefashis. It was a life or death situation. In fact, she later learned that her husband had only eaten black bread and water for 6 months. And so she hired she got a non-Jewish girl to carry the package to the prison. She walked along with them. And she knew that if she did not get him his package on that day, he'd have to wait another 10 days. And she was certain that he did not eat any of the prison food. Here, 4 kilos. We took 4 kilos and we walked 4 kilos of food. So after waiting from 7 a.m. till 7 p.m, by which time it was completely dark, I received a note which the commanding officer read aloud to all of the people waiting in the room, though she says they did not really understand what it meant, but just I and the officers did. She said that the prisoner answered, since today is Shabbos, I did not accept the package. She goes on to write that to cope with such an experience, one needed my husband's resoluteness and piety. And this is despite the fact that for 6 months he was only on bread and water. She says, but don't worry, he got more pleasure from refusing that package than he would have gotten from eating what was in it. And then later on, she says, she herself was interrogated several times. They were trying to get information from her. And she says she's pleased to say that she did not share any information whatsoever. I'm going to jump ahead to the next selection. This was after they begin, she starts hearing regards from some of the people who are at least doing a little bit to help her, to inform her. She starts getting regards that the Rebbe's father, that the file says that he's a member of the Schneerson clan, meaning he's a chassid, he has some connection with the Friedrich Rebbe. But this particular one that we're looking at now speaks about how she went to Kazil Orda, which is a little bit larger city next to Chiali in Kazakhstan, where he was, where the Rebbe's father was exiled. And she found a Jew there. And she finally found somebody who was a sheikhet who she could trust, and she ate in the sheikhet's home and stayed with his family for a little bit. She spent 10 days there trying to get permission for her husband to move there. And she submitted a petition asking that her husband's health is in such terrible condition that they should be able to move him to a somewhat larger city of Kazil Orda. But at that point is when she found out that his file says he must not be allowed to live amongst Jews, which is going to be relevant later when we see some of the other documents that we have here. And the final thing I'm going to mention, for those who just came on, I just want to tell you that we are in the Rebbe's library here. We're on the third floor of 770, which we showed before. We're in the exhibition room. I'm told that there is a couple hundred people on, some of whom joined after we did the introduction. So, and we are going through some original documents by and about Rebbe Tzimchana in advance of her birthday, 143rd birthday, upcoming this Shabbos. The sixth one, I have a soft spot always for everything related to Simchas Torah. So this one is about Simchas Torah in exile. I should tell you before we continue that we mentioned that there were going to be four specific documents. Right before we started, Rabbi Levin actually brought two very, very special treats that I don't think have ever been seen before. Certainly one of them has not been seen before. And at the end, we're going to be able to share a couple of things that I know that I have never seen before. And I don't think they've been seen by anyone outside of the library staff. So thank you to Rabbi Levin, and please stick around for that. This one is about Simchas Torah. Rabbi Tzimchana writes that Simchas Torah, we didn't yet have a Torah in our possession. It's already, I think it's 1943, it's during the war, and more Jews are coming to this place. So they had like what you can call a little bit of a shul, meaning that a few Jews got together. To call it a shul is obviously impossible if you read her accounts of how dire, absolutely crazy the situation was. But she speaks about how my husband recited the verses of the Akafis, Ata Reis Aladas, with such passion as though he was in his shul. Ata Reis Aladas Kasher, Avayahu Elikim Enoid Mavadoi. Remember seeing it? We were looking before. The way she writes it out. And then she writes about how he sang and he danced with such energy. Talking about Rikudim, Pashat Rikudim, Tansen, the way that he celebrated Simchas Torah with the tune that he would sing it back in their home in Yekaterinoslav, which we know as the Rebbe's father's Hakafisnig, and she says it was Simchas Torah. There's no Sefer Torah. There were just a handful of Jews. They went to one of the homes. It's the time to be happy. Azah Simcha. You could think that there was absolutely nothing wrong. Every single pasuk he said with a tremendous fervor, and each pasuk on its own, and he did it like he was celebrating Simchas Torah back in their home. And then he sang Sisu B'Simcha B'Simchas Torah in that same way. Okay, one final thing I'm going to, from here, because it's related to Rebbe Tzimchana's birthday, and that is that she writes on her, if I recall correctly, her 74th birthday, Yom HaChavav Tevis. She writes that I'm writing on my birthday, but one of the things that she writes, that my husband's life was a tragedy when he was alive, and a tragedy afterwards because his writings are not yet published. And again, I'm saying this as a way of introducing what we're going to be going over to next. Next up is the Tehillim or the Zohar? I'm trying to, okay. Now here we have, this is very, very well known. This, one of the things that Rebbe told the story a number of times, that the situation was so dire where Rebbe Levi Yitzchak and Rebbe Tzimchana were in exile. There was no ink, there was no paper. One of the things that pained him more than anything else, both the Rebbe says this actually, and Rebbe Tzimchana writes it, was the fact that he had no Jews with whom to share his Torah teachings or his Torah thoughts, with whom to do anything. And he couldn't even write his Torah thoughts. And when Rebbe Tzimchana saw this, one of the things that she did is she bought some powder in Kazil Orda when she was able to, and some ink. And she says that was even a greater joy to him than the food that she brought him. But then at a different point, she actually went out into the field and so the ink was a number of different colors. But this, because he didn't have paper, He didn't have a normal way to write, and because he didn't have ink, as you'll see here, these are the three volumes of Zohar from the Rebbe's father. Rebbe Tzimchan actually brought it to him, brought these svarim, these volumes to him in Chile, and he wrote, because she was not a professional ink maker, they're all different colors. But the Rebbe talks about how this was, first of all, she talks about the simcha, the joy that this brought Reb Levi Yitzchak, when he was able to write down these Torah teachings, and also the actual Torah thoughts themselves are saved. These are, the Rebbe's father was a Mekubal. These are mostly on Kabbalah and interpreting and explaining different parts of the Torah in his unique style, which has been developed further and further by a number of scholars over this last few years. These volumes were actually saved. Rebbe Tzimchana once mentioned to Reb Pinya Altois how pained she is that these volumes that she smuggled out of Chile with her, and after her husband's passing, after her husband's passing in Alma-Ata, she smuggled them to Moscow. When she reached Moscow several months after his passing, she had to leave the volumes there because she was going out as on false papers as a Polish citizen. And she gave them to Reb Nisim Klufgan. And when Rebbe Tzimchana said this to Reb Pinya Altois, it took about 2 years, a project of 2 years, but there was this Jew named Moshe Klug who was visiting Moscow. He went and he got the volumes, and they were actually smuggled out in a diplomatic pouch by the Israeli embassy. It was too dangerous even for any Russian Jews to give it to any Israeli diplomatic officer. But this foreigner who was in town was able to get the books in what they call a dead drop in espionage. They left the book somewhere, and then he came later and he picked it up, and he brought it to the Israeli consulate. Eventually, it made it to Israel, and then they were brought to the Rebbe here, and then they were published. This operation took 2 years. It finished in Tav Shin Chaf, 1959. A short time later, several years later, more writings of the Rebbe's father came, and then the Rebbe started publishing them and speaking about them. They're known as Lekutei Levi Yitzchak, Torah Levi Yitzchak. So these are the original volumes. By the way, if you come here to the library on any day, these volumes are actually here inside a showcase. So you could see them, and you could see them for yourself, the original thing. Sometimes the most beautiful and precious treasures are hiding in plain sight. You can come in, you're invited to make a small donation to the library, but they're here and they're available. Okay, our next document that we want to look at is a Tehillim. This Tehillim was brought to Reb Levi Yitzchak, the Rebbe's father, in Chile, by a Jewish prisoner or officer it was. He says that Reb Levi Yitzchak asked him for several items. He recognized when he said a chumash, and he recognized the tilim, and he recognized a siddur, a prayer book, and the five books of Moses, and the Psalms, which this is. He did not recognize when he asked for a tanya, what that was. But there's a whole drama around how he found Rebbe Tzimchana's house, and he walked straight into the house, so he shouldn't have to look for her. Anyway, but he brought this, apparently, this is when he got this tilim. And Rebbe Tzimchana writes a beautiful inscription in the front of this Tehillim. And she writes about the Tehillim. Or is it? I think it's in the back. Oh, here it is. Zeha Tehillim, Shayach Lebai Lizal, Sheshalachti Loi, Al Pi Bakasha Say, oh, this was in Chile. Okay, so this did not come to him right in the beginning in prison. But I sent him on his request to the place of his exile in the town of Chiali, in the village of Chiali, in the country of Kazakhstan. Lu hayu peh v'loshen l'hadapim ha'elu, hayu lehem l'saper harbe harbe. Were these papers in March 1939, his physical state, his physical strength got worse and worse day by day. His mood was strong. It was very difficult, though. Not his mood, his spirit was strong. It was very difficult for me to hear the cries that came out from the depths of his heart, his broken heart, that he suffered more from the lack of spiritual life than suffering from actual hunger. And he truly was hungry. There was no bread, and there were just terrible, terrible conditions of life. The Sefer was with him until his passing on the 20th of 1944 in Almaty, which is the capital city of the above-mentioned country, Kazakhstan. Rabbi Tzachana likely wrote this, I mean, certainly after the passing of Reb Levi Yitzchak, I would say likely she wrote it in the United States, although it's difficult to know for sure. You look at the front, and it has actually, it's engraved with Rabbi Tzachana's name. Again, hard to know if it was before or after, but I'm going to guess it was before. Might be wrong, though. If there are any questions, please feel free to ask. Send them as a comment, or how else can they give in questions? Send in the questions, however you do it, down there below. What are we up to here? I want to share a story, which is kind of a light story, but to me, it's a very, very telling story. It's a story that I've heard a couple times recently from Mrs. Miriam Swerdlov. Because after you hear, we hear just a little bit about the tremendous anguish and the tremendous, really, torture that Rabbi Tzachana was through during all these years. To then hear a story like this is just really, is really, to me, exceptional. And that is that Rabbi Tzachana, when she was here in New York, she lived in 1414 President Street, 1418, and there was a woman who was like an aide who lived with her, and she had to go away for a few days. And Mrs. Swerdlov, as a young teenager, was asked to spend the night with Rabbi Tzachana for a couple of nights. Her mother knew Rabbi Tzachana. And she stayed there, and she was in a bedroom, and she was, like as kids do, she was looking around at some of the different things, and there was something on top of the dresser, like this little chest, and she was trying to get it open, she couldn't get it open, and finally, boom, she opened it up, and powder flew everywhere. It was some kind of powder or makeup or face powder or something like that. And what could she do? She's alone in the house with Rabbi Tzachana, and she messed up, and what kind of terrible thing did she do? She started crying. Rabbi Tzachana, after a few minutes, heard her. She came in, she gave one look at what's happening, and she right away helped her clean up the mess. And then, after they finished, Rabbi Tzachana sat down next to her and said, "This will be our secret. Let's not tell anybody about what happened here." Now, of course, Mrs. Swerdlov says that the thing she was most afraid of is that her parents would find out, or the Rebbe would find out about this, how she messed up. But the ability for Rebbe Tzachana, who at that time what must have been, you know, approaching 70 years old, or somewhere right around there, with all she had been through, with all of the hardships, to be able to zone in on the feelings of a teenage girl, and what it is that she would be afraid of, just shows to me, but you can interpret it however you want. But one thing is for sure, it's not unfamiliar to those of us who know the Rebbe or who observe the Rebbe to see that kind of sensitivity. The Rebbe's mother, so it's not surprising, but it's still beautiful. I just want to point out a couple quick things before we go to these special treats that I mentioned to you. And that is that in 1964, less than a year before Rabbi Tzachana passed away, Lekutei Sichas Chelek Gimel came out. Now, the way it works is with the preface to every Kohos Sefer, Kohos book, the Rebbe, they give it in, the Rebbe might edit or review the preface, and then the Rebbe would fill in the date. And here, you can almost... almost looks like it's begging to be called out Chavdalah Tevis, which we should mention. Tonight is Chavdalah Tevis. If we have a moment, if we have time, we will do something about Chavdalah Tevis related to this, generally this time period. But the Rebbe writes Chavches Tevis, and at the time, nobody knew what that was. Chavches Tevis Tavshin Chavdalah. Obviously, it was much later that people discovered that this was the Rebbe's mother's, Rebbe Tzachana's birthday, and in fact, this was her last birthday. She passed away Vav Tishrei, Tafshin Chafei, less than a year later. The Rebbe dated, look at the Sichas, perhaps you can call it a birthday gift to his mother, but the Rebbe dated the Pesach Davar, his mother's birthday. Just a little something, as we know, there are thousands and thousands of girls who are named after Rebbe Tzimchana. I have a Chana myself, Zolzi Zayin Gesund, and there are many others. The first girl who was named after Rebbe Tzimchana was born Ches Tishrei, so that's Sunday night. Rebbe Tzimchana passed away on Shabbos, and Sunday night, Chana Katzman at the time, today her name is Chana Weiss, she's a shlucha in North Carolina. I believe she was born on Ches Tishrei Tavshil Chafei, Sunday night. Monday morning, her father was allowed into Shiva, to the minyan, to the Torah reading, where the Rebbe was sitting Shiva, and he's a Kayan, so he received the first Aliyah. When it came time to name the baby, he kind of turned and asked the Rebbe's permission if he could name after the Rebbe's mother. And the Rebbe gave a big smile, and he said, Arichus Yamin V'shanim Tevis. May she have many long, good, healthy years, and they gave the name. And the Rebbe would write a letter on the birth of any child, a boy or a girl, and the Rebbe added in Ksav Yad, in his own handwriting, he changed the letter, modified the letter. Typically it says the girl's name, and Shetichya, may she be well, the Rebbe changed it to read Shetilita, which is what you write for Tzadekis or something like that. And that's something that the Rebbe actually kept on. A Chana, the Rebbe would add the word, the letter would read Shetilita. Here you have it. This is that first one. This is the Rebbe actually writing, changing the Shetichya to Shetilita. And I believe the same thing was with Rebbe Tzimchaya Mushka, that the Rebbe did this. The Rebbe made no secret, obviously, and the Rebbe's Kibud Eim is not the subject of tonight's broadcast. It's legendary. There are so many stories about it, but it's just interesting, specifically after passing these couple of things, where we see how much the Rebbe clearly and openly expressed his appreciation, whether it was an institution that was named after a child, or I should maybe say it the other way, a child that was named after Rebbe Tzimchana, an institution that was named after her. And the Rebbe was very clear and open about how much he appreciated it. And this letter that was sent to Rabbi Katzman actually had a PS, and the Rebbe wrote, I'm going to be mishtate, I'm going to participate in the costs of her education, and he gave a check for $63, which is the numerical value of Chana. A few weeks later, on Chanukah of that year, the Katzman family was in Yechidus, each of the children got $1, and the Chana got $10 of Chanukah geld. The following year, when Reb Zelig was in Yechidus, and the Rebbe asked, when is her birthday, about the child? So he said, I write in all my children's names and birthdays at my birthday when I go in. The Rebbe said, though, she is especially relevant to me because she's the first Chana. Anyway, now we're going to go to these two. We're going to make a bit of a, we're going to walk around once, and then we're going to go back for those two special treats. Because I did not have the opportunity to show you the Rebbe's showcase before. This is by now the very well-known photo of the Rebbe as a child before Upsharnish, and this is the original. You might not recognize it with the crack that was when it was published. It's been fixed up, but here's the original photo taken by M. Kramer Photographers in Nikolaev. That's what it says there on the bottom right. And this is a photo of the Rebbe, presumed to be around the time of his wedding in Warsaw, though we can't know that for sure. And here's the Rebbe's Chanukah menorah. If you ever wondered what type of menorah the Rebbe lit Chanukah lichten, there it is. And a couple of items from the Rebbe's Seder. This gold becher, gold kiddush cup. The Rebbe would, it was a gift, it was pure gold, that the Rebbe actually would use during the Pesach Seder. Below that silver tray is what the Rebbe used for his kaira. That would go under the matzahs. And here, when you pour the wine during the Seder, you see that broken bowl. That's what the Rebbe would pour it into, in certain years at least. Okay, let's go. We have over here Rabbi Levin, who I was telling you about, the chief librarian of the Rebbe's library. And although we expressed our appreciation before, I want to do it again with him present, and especially for everything that you help with GEM. Everything that we do is really possible. The Living Torah team, I could tell you, they call the library staff on a regular basis. I want to thank you very much for all the help. I hope you recognize how much the Olam that watches the videos appreciates it, but it's not just the videos, the Svarim, the books, everything, all the manuscripts, all of the documents, almost all of them, the source is the Rebbe's library. This certainly is the repository of all of that, and you and the staff are incredibly kind to us and to everyone. I want to once again urge everyone to come here to the Rebbe's library to see this exhibition for yourself. It's hiding in plain sight, but there's absolute treasures here. Thank you, Rabbi Levin. So here we have two things that just right before we went on the air, Rabbi Levin kindly brought out. One is this letter from the Friedrich Rebbe, the previous Rebbe, to his Mechuteneste, meaning the mother-in-law of his daughter, Harabanes HaNichbada Maras Chana Shlita. This is dated the 24th of Elul, 1948, Brooklyn, New York. Bracha v'shalom is greeting her as we approach the new year, this year that is upcoming for us and all the Jewish people in our Holy Land and in the entire world, wherever they are spread out. I hereby bless my mechutenes, the distinguished rabbitzin, and our shared children, may they be well. And your son, this is the other son, Vespina Ubnei Beisa Yichyu. So this is going to be Vespina Stroy Leib. I wonder if Vespina, okay, I'm not sure. Ubnei Beisa Yichyu Bevichs Hashana for the new year. Ki Yashpia Hashem Yisbarech Lachen Ulechol Haniskarim Boza, that Hashem should grant you and everyone I mentioned above, and to all of us amongst our brethren, the Jewish people, a good, sweet, healthy year, materially and spiritually. L'shana tovah t'kasev v'sichas, may be written and inscribed for a good year. Your mechutan, who honors you and blesses you, and the Friedrich Rebbe's signature. This is from 1948, Tuesday, the 24th of El. And now this. So, we know that in 1947, the Rebbe went to Paris as soon as his mother came out of Poland, came out of the refugee camp in Pocking, which was in Germany. She came to France. That was her first place. Immediately, the Rebbe embarked to greet her and to see her to the United States. In the end, it took several months, much longer than the Rebbe had expected. It took for Rebbe Tzachana to get her papers. Here we have what seems to be a French passport. I haven't translated the French yet, but certainly something similar to a passport. This is, it's a voyage of identification. Identification for a voyage. One thing I do know is that after World War II, there were many different types of papers because people literally had no papers. So I'm guessing that this is a similar paper. There was a certain types of visas, nonsense visas, as they were called. So I'm guessing this is a French paper because it looks like it doesn't say passport on it. But these are Rebbe Tzachana's papers, which she received then. Did you have a look here? You went, okay. And it's valid until, I think it says 1960 or 47, something seven. We'll have to study it a little bit more, 67. And this seems to be the American, I think this is the American visa, or somewhere here we're going to be upcoming on the American visa. This is some type of, she's embarked for the United States. And you'll have to forgive me, I didn't have a chance to study it yet. This is looking at it pretty much for the first time now. June 2nd, 1947. This is her signature. Cherbourg, that's probably where she embarked from. Wait, but there was someone asked to see the photo. Give us a minute. We'll go back to the photo. I just want to see what else there is here. Here you have some type of stamp. American consulate, I think. American. Yeah, consulate, probably somewhere in France. So this is from the American consulate, the stamp, giving her permission to come, presumably. And then this is Immigration Naturalization Service, June 16th, 1947. I'm going to guess that that's Chavches Sivan, because that's the day that they came back. It's likely the day that they, that date. Here we are again in the beginning. Okay, thank you. Levin, thank you again for staying here so late and for allowing us to opening up for all the hundreds, eventually thousands of people who I hope you realize it's not just me you're letting in, or it's not me at all. It's my the pleasure, thousands who will.
My pleasure to help you with such an interesting project.
Thank you again very much. And everybody's invited to support the library and to come here and to allow them to continue doing this more and more. I want to finish off with one last thing related to Chavdalah Teves, if you'll allow me, guys. Yeah, I think we're doing okay on time. And that is, there's a beautiful letter from the Rebbe's father to the Rebbe and his brother, Leibel, Rabbi Yisrael Aryeh Leib, that he writes on Chavdalah Teves, Tafresh Tzadik Beis, 1932. I'm looking for my papers here. One second, we'll walk around a little bit, I guess. And it's about Chavdalah Teves. It's a long letter. I'm not a mekubal. I can't, I'm not going to try and teach you the letter now, but it's fascinating. There's some really, really interesting things here. So this is printed in Likutei Levi Yitzchok Igros Kodesh. Matzoy Shabbos Kodesh Parsha Shmai. So this was the same kvios as the, when the Alter Rebbe was nostalgic. Yemilula Rabbi Rosh Kol B'nei HaGoyla. Just interesting. The head of all the exiles, he refers to the Alter Rebbe. My sons, my beloved, dear sons. Tonight is the night of the passing of the Alter Rebbe. Passed away in Tafkafayin Gimel, Matzoy Shabbos Kodesh, Chavdalah Teves. Okay, and then he goes in to explain what Chavdalah is, what Teves is. He compares the Alter Rebbe's histalkus to the passing of Reb Shimon ben Yochai on Lag BaOmer. And he goes in and he explains Teves, the 24th, Alter Rebbe's name. Schneier is connected to Teves, I believe. Zalman is connected to Chavdalah, to 24th. And he goes on and on and explains everything according to Kabbalah. Then he says something very interesting that he learned from his father, the Baruch Schneer, who we were talking about before. I'm still looking for the papers that I printed out with them. I have a two-page thing of the Rebbe's father's letter to him. Gentlemen. Oh, here it is. Okay. And then his father, the Baruch Schneer, had just passed away less than a year before, and his first Yahrzeit was coming up, and he talks about his father, who was named Schneer Zalman. The name Baruch was added later. And he speaks about that as well. And he says that my father told me that he heard from the Rebbe Marash that the author of the Shagas Aryeh studied the entire Gemara 600 times, the entire Talmud. The Alter Rebbe completed Talmud and its commentary 16 times by the time he was 30. And according to the Rebbe Marash, these 16 times were a greater achievement than the Shagas Aryeh 600 times. That's not what I wanted to step into as much as to the interesting thing here, or one of the many interesting things here. When the Rebbe's father writes this to him, the Rebbe is 30 years old. And it's right before his father's first Yahrzeit. And he says, the Alter Rebbe was 30 years of age. 30 is a year, is a time of Gvura. And he goes into, again, the number 30 and the relationship between 30 and strength. The Rebbe himself makes notations on this letter. And then there's a Rishima, in Rishimas, it's Chiveres, it's number 168, where the Rebbe writes a note on his father's letter. So tonight is Chavdalah Teves. It is the Yahrzeit of the Alter Rebbe. Obviously, everything we're doing here, the Rebbe, Rebbe Tzinchana, we're all the offspring, the spiritual offspring of the Alter Rebbe. In fact, the Rebbe is the physical offspring of the Alter Rebbe as well. It's very apropos that we're having this gathering, this hakel, here today. I want to remind you again that there's a number of links. There's a biography of Rebbe Tzachana on Chabad.org. You're invited to become a member in Gem.tv and watch the full film. I'm told there are badges you can buy to donate as well. That would be that's very much appreciated. And I would be remiss if I did not use this tremendous opportunity of Jews gathering from around the world which is a hakel during this year. Everything has a special inspiration of it's a year of hakel. Oh, I forgot. There's also a Rishima, together with that, from the Rebbe's father that same year, about 2 weeks later, 2 weeks after this letter that I mentioned to you, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Tafresh Tzadik Beis, 1932 was a Shnas Hakel, and there's a long, the Rebbe's father goes into the whole idea that it's Hakel, a year of gathering. And I would like to ask everyone to say a quick prayer and give tzedakah, some charity, in the merit of my sister, Henya Rivka, Bas Brachad Vareleya, that she should have an immediate, speedy and miraculous recovery, and rejoin her family and her kinderlach immediately. Okay, I want to give a special thank you here to Rabbi Yisrael Slonim, who's the director of engagement and social media, to Mendel Greenberg, who's behind the camera, Mendel Barber, who runs our Instagram. I just got the tally before Shabbos. It was over 230,000 members in all of our different social media platforms. There's a link tree. We have, I think, six languages, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, LinkedIn. I'm forgetting some of them. What are the other ones? Anyway, and more in numerous languages. You're invited to enjoy videos of the Rebbe in any language and at any time, and to follow on all of these platforms. I want to thank you for your support. We hope you enjoyed this tonight. Thank you to to our entire staff who makes all of this possible. Thank you to our financial supporters and the members of the GEM Foundation. We hope you were inspired by this. And as we approach Shabbos, make sure to have a Febrengen in honor of Rebbe Tzimchana, the Rebbe's mother, and not at all least, Rebbe Tzimchana is interred right here, only several feet away from the Rebbe's oil. You're invited. You don't have to get on a plane to Kazakhstan to go visit her. You can just go right here, get in your car. Rebbe Tzimchana is right here. You can pay her a visit when you go to the Rebbe at the oil. And the Rebbe himself always used to go there. And I have no doubt that the Rebbe will appreciate the kibbutz eim aspect of that as well, the honoring his mother, as every child must honor their mother. Anyway, thank you very much for joining us. Good night, and we'll see you next time.